This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Mosaic, a daily news program from Link TV, presents a selection of news reports from independent and state-controlled broadcasters from throughout the Middle East.
Let's watch this report about the ongoing preparations for the Arab summit in Doha with a presentation of the most prominent issues on the agenda.
48 ساعه وتنطلق القمه العربيه الحاديه والعشرين.
There are 48 hours until the start of the 21st Arab Summit in Doha. Amidst a state of divisions from the coast to the Gulf, it could be said that this is the most difficult summit in the history of the Arab League. People are hoping the leaders at the meeting will make decisions that are different than those that emerged from the previous summits, especially with regards to implementing collaborative Arab efforts, not just talking about them. This is in addition to resolving many differences in perspectives and positions towards various issues, which have had a negative impact on such collaborative efforts for many decades. The Arab summit faces many challenges, the most prominent being the prevalent divisions amongst the Arabs and the challenges from both moderate and hardline countries.
القمة العربية أمام تحديات كثيرة أبرزها حالة الانقسام السائدة على الساحة.
The state of division has existed on the Palestinian political landscape for the past 2 years. The following issues will top the agenda: the reconstruction of the Gaza Strip, the halt of the peace process, the fate of the Arab Peace Initiative, which was proposed at the Beirut summit, the International Criminal Court's arrest warrant for Sudanese President Omar Hassan al-Bashir, as Sudan is a member of the Arab League, the Iranian nuclear file, the Iraqi file, the Lebanese file, the Darfur crisis, and the issue of the Emirates Islands, the economy, and the various effects of the global economic crisis on the Arab world.
وأزمة دارفور وملف الجزر الإماراتية والملف الاقتصادي وانعكاسات الأزمة الاقتصادية العالمية على العالم العربي من مختلف النواحي.
The Arab summit in Doha will be the first during the term of the new U.S. President Barack Obama, who had promised the world to formulate a new foreign policy based on mutual respect and interests.
بانتهاج سياسة خارجية جديدة تعتمد على الاحترام المتبادل والمصالح المشتركة.
It is being held only days before Benjamin Netanyahu will take the helm of a new Israeli government, which is made up of right-wing extremists. All this demonstrates the extent of the challenges that the Arab leaders will face at the 21st Arab summit in Doha.
تواجه الزعماء والقادة العرب في القمة العربية الحادية والعشرين في الدوحة.
This summit has been preceded by many preliminary reconciliation summits aimed at easing the current tense atmosphere and division. Thus, the Gaza summit was held, as well as the Kuwaiti Economic Summit, Sharm el-Sheikh Summit, the Riyadh Four-Way Summit, and many other bilateral summits.
وعدة قمم ثنائية. الزعماء والقادة العرب إذن أمام كم هائل من التحديات.
Arab leaders face a huge number of challenges. What is being demanded of them is that they rise to these challenges in order to reach a clear, defined Arab strategy that directly responds to the minimal needs of the vulnerable Arab street.
للحد الأدنى من أمان الشارع العربي المغلوب على أمره. بأننا فعلا أمة عربية.
This is so that we can truly be a united Arab world with the ability to formulate policies in order to confront the daunting challenges which affect everyone. The Arab leaders must also deal with the reality on the ground by making decisions that can actually be implemented, not just ones that are for media consumption.
The office of the Israeli Prime Minister said that the spokesperson for prisoner affairs, Ofer Dekel, has said that at the end of this week they will once again try to draft a prisoner exchange deal with the Hamas movement. However, the Prime Minister's office has not disclosed whether Ofer Dekel will be traveling to Egypt. According to Israeli sources, Dekel and the head of the Egyptian intelligence services, Omar Suleiman, are seeking to convince the Hamas leadership to soften its position on the prisoner exchanges.
Meanwhile, during the cabinet meeting, the Israeli prison administration called for imposing new restrictions on Hamas prisoners due to the failure of the prisoner swap deal. Our correspondent, Elias Karam, followed up on the last session of the outgoing Prime Minister Ehud Olmert and prepared the following report.
At Ehud Olmert's last assembly, there were discussions of preliminary recommendations which were prepared by the Special Ministerial Committee calling for additional restrictions for the prisoners of Hamas and Islamic Jihad. The committee was formed in response to the failure of the Egyptian-sponsored prisoner swap deal with Hamas and also in response to the ban on the Red Cross from visiting the Israeli prisoner Gilad Shalit, who was held in Gaza. The ministerial committee is making efforts to renew the arrest of the Palestinian prisoners whose release Hamas has called for, in accordance with the prisoner exchange deal. However, the committee did not call for banning the Red Cross from visiting the prisoners in accordance with international law, a move that was welcomed by the ministers.
There are an abundance of Hamas terrorists in Israeli prisons that are being treated fairly. However, our prisoner is not allowed visitor privileges so that we may check on his condition, not even one visitor.
The restrictions include the reduction of the money given to the prisoners, a decrease in the number of allowed visits, and a ban on inmates to hug their children. In addition, they will take away their rights to watch TV, listen to the radio, and read the newspaper. Prisoners are also being banned from pursuing a higher education. All these restrictions have been criticized by those concerned with prisoners' affairs.
Israel is attempting to turn itself into a gang, and in turn, they are officially transforming the Hamas prisoners into hostages.
These restrictions were preceded by an arrest campaign carried out recently by the occupying authorities against political leaders of the Hamas movement in the West Bank, and they do not seem to be swaying Hamas from its demands.
Gilad Shalit will not be released as long as our brave prisoners are not released in accordance with conditions of the Palestinian resistance.
Until Benjamin Netanyahu swears in his government before the Israeli Knesset next Tuesday, it seems that last-minute efforts will continue in order to reach a prisoner swap deal. Meanwhile, Ehud Olmert has sent his special envoy for prisoners' affairs, Ofer Dekel, into a new round of talks without disclosure of details. Israel wants to either retaliate or move the prisoner swap deal forward while pressuring Hamas. However, this may push Israel into a new confrontation with Palestinian prisoners who in the past engaged in a long struggle to improve their prisoners' conditions. Elias Karam, Al Jazeera, West Jerusalem.
Day commemorations were held in Arab communities throughout the country today. Local residents held marches and peaceful demonstrations. The main ceremony was held in the village of Deir Hana in the north. Demonstrators waved flags and slammed government policies, which they hold responsible for the confiscation of their land. Several Arab Knesset members and prominent public figures were among the marchers. Land Day commemorates the killing of six Arab citizens by the IDF and police in 1976. During protests over what they claim was seizure of Arab-owned land.
Unprecedented losses for tycoon Lev Levayev's Africa Israel Group. The company announced losses today of 4.9 billion shekels. It was the sharpest drop for a business in the country's history. Levayev attributed the huge losses to the global economic crisis, the drop in value of real estate, and an enormous hike in the cost of financing. There are good years and bad years, said Levayev at a press conference today, but he assured the public that the company has one of the best management teams around and looks forward to a positive future. Ironically, company stocks took a sharp upward turn in the wake of predictions for a positive financial report in 2009.
Heading to According to the initial results of the municipal elections in Turkey, the ruling Justice and Development Party is ahead of its rivals. However, there is dissatisfaction with the party's leader, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. With only 39% of the vote, the Turkish Prime Minister did not receive a strong mandate to carry out the needed reforms to get Turkey into the European Union. Asma Tarabi reports.
Large-scale public celebrations were held expressing the joy of victory for the ruling party in the municipal elections. They were not eclipsed by the fact that it wasn't a sweeping victory. Despite the fact that partial results indicate that the Justice and Development Party led against rival parties by 39%, the results were placed in the column of defeats for the leader of the party, Recep Tayyip Erdogan. Why is this? The elections were like a referendum on his party and his leadership.
Turkish voters gave a very clear message.
Turkish voters gave a very clear message to the governing AK party that its policies have to be revised. They have to be revised politically and economically. During the election campaign, Prime Minister Erdogan ignored the global economic crisis and said that it would have no serious effect on Turkey. It appears that he was not able to convince the Turkish voters.
The economic contraction and the rise in the rate of unemployment in Turkey are factors for why the Justice and Development Party did not get a strong backing in the elections. The decline in its popularity may make it more difficult to carry out reforms which Erdogan promised and which will require essential changes.
Change is expected regardless of the results of the elections.
A new scenario may emerge as an exit strategy for Erdogan, the start of a new campaign for reforms. If his voting numbers fall below 40%, another scenario may emerge, pressure by the opposition to hold early legislative elections.
An Iraqi security source said that several army units have withdrawn from the Fadil district in Baghdad. This news comes after clashes erupted between the Iraqi security forces and fighters from the Iraqi Sawa Awakening Council over the Sawa chief's arrest.
The area of Fadil in the center of the Iraqi capital of Baghdad is witnessing calm but with caution after 2 days of violent clashes erupted between Sunni Sahwa fighters on one side and joint U.S. and Iraqi police and security forces on the other. More than four people were killed and nearly 15 others were wounded in the clashes. In addition, five Iraqi soldiers were reported missing, but a police source said that the soldiers have been captured by Sahwa fighters. Meanwhile, the Iraqi and U.S. forces heightened security measures in and around the entrances of the Fadil district. According to eyewitnesses, armored vehicles were seen patrolling the main streets in Fadil. Also, Iraqi snipers and troops were deployed throughout the district. The Iraqi military also issued warning messages over loudspeakers, calling on Sunni Sahwa fighters to either surrender or face arrest or death.
The security measures we have taken are due to the incidents that took place yesterday in the area of Fadil. These are ordinary measures which are temporary and they are due to expire at 12 p.m. The security forces were doing their job and got help from the residents, including some from the Fadil group, who made it easier on us.
The security deterioration between U.S. forces and the Sahwa Council, who were until 2 days ago a U.S. ally against armed al-Qaeda fighters, comes after the arrest of Adel al-Mashhadani, the head of the Sahwa Council in the area of Fadil in Baghdad. Al-Mashhadani was arrested along with one of his aides for collaborating with al-Qaeda. There are about 94,000 members of the Sahwa Council in Iraq, and 54,000 of them are in the province of Baghdad. The Sahwa fighters have helped to curb the level of violence in Iraq after joining the Iraqi and U.S. forces against armed al-Qaeda fighters. Salim Abu Asla, Al Arabiya.
From the Fadil neighborhood, we traveled on the road of Nihib, which links Iraq to Saudi Arabia, as well as linking Anbar with other Iraqi provinces. Until recently, the Nihib road has been a very dangerous road to travel on. Our correspondent, Majid Hamid, traveled on the Nihib Road and prepared the following report.
Terror was associated with traveling on the desert road of Nahib in the Anbar province. Armed men have often planted roadside bombs along the Nahib road, targeting travelers. However, life has returned to normal after security measures have been heightened deep in the desert.
Generally speaking, the road is in good working condition. However, it needs minor repairs. As far as security is concerned, the road is very safe. The police are being deployed along the road. The road is 100% secure.
The road, which was until recently dangerous to travel on due to kidnappings, killings, and robberies, has been declared secure. The road connects Iraq with its neighbors on one side and links Anbar with other Iraqi provinces on the other. Several Iraqi pilgrims were killed a few years ago on this road by armed groups.
The road is safe and operational. We would like to express our gratitude to the members of the police and army forces and to all the good people in the province. Thank God. Before, we couldn't travel on this road. Now the road is safe to travel on.
The security mechanism deployed by checkpoints along this road is different than those deployed by other roadblocks due to the presence of nomadic tribes. This requires additional inspections in order to stop the return of armed fighters, disguised in Bedouin clothing, to the deserts of Nahib. From the desert of Nahib and Anbar, Majid Hamid, Al Arabiya.
The crimes of the former regime remain in the memory of the people. A woman from Karbala lost five of her children and still clearly remembers those crimes, even though the regime fell 6 years ago.
Those children, along with other martyrs, bled for the sake of freedom and created a future full of glory that will be remembered by all the generations to come.
More than 18 years have passed, but this woman still has pictures of her sons displayed everywhere. This woman still wipes the pictures of her sons with her handkerchief that is wet with her tears, the tears that seem to never dry up. What will it take for her tears to stop, and how will her soul rest if she still cannot find any signs of her sons after searching in prisons and at mass graves?
All of a sudden, they disappeared. I have no idea what happened to them. They disappeared in 1991. All of a sudden, I didn't hear from them anymore, and I didn't see any news written about them in the newspaper.
She tried her best to find out what Saddam's gangs did to them, hoping to find them or find out what happened to them. Instead, she was imprisoned and tortured with her younger daughters. She then fled from one city to another to escape from imprisonment and torture.
They told me that they were going to release them, but it was all lies. I gave one of them 10 million dinars, and they still didn't release them. Then they imprisoned me, along with my daughters.
This strong woman has dedicated many harsh years of her life for her country that her children bled for. That very same country has become free, which Iraqis take in like air. After all of this dedication, the Iraqi government must support these families who have suffered.
My daughter is looking for a job, and no one is employing her. I have asked the Prime Minister to take care of my daughter. We are all victims, and I need help.
This woman is only one of the thousands of women who have lost their children and husbands under the regime that was in love with killing and torture. Here she is today. Have her wounds healed, or has she forgotten the torture she endured? From Karbala, Ali Hussein Hamza, Al Arabiya.
عثر
The Iraqi army found weapon caches and explosive devices in the Abu Ghraib area. Security officials in the area said that the armed groups have begun to build up weapon caches with the objective of using them as bases to launch military operations whenever they have an opportunity. We leave you with Hizam al-Shara.
The security efforts that were exerted by the Iraqi forces in northern and eastern Baghdad, with the help of some tribes, expelled al-Qaeda from these areas. Abu Ghraib witnessed a notable increase in military activity in the past few days. The Iraqi forces, in cooperation with the local residents, were able to find the hideouts of an armed group and confiscated special equipment and explosive devices that were made recently.
كارتات تخص العبوات اللي هي يكون تحكم عنها عن بعد اللي تعمل بطريقة.
The explosive devices can be detonated from a distance through a cellular phone. We found large quantities of these explosives. These explosives were imported because they were newly made. They were specifically made to carry out these kinds of armed attacks.
ومصنع خصيصا لمثل هذه الأعمال.
In the area of Umm Yasir, where the hideout was found, the Iraqi army believes that the armed groups have built a number of caches there so that they can be used as a base to launch armed attacks whenever there is an opportunity.
كل الفعاليات اللي كانت يعني عندنا تفاصيل كاملة وملقين القبض على كافة الإرهابيين الفعاليين.
We have completed details about the armed group's activities. We have arrested all active terrorists in this cell. The Umm Yasir area is relatively calm, but terrorists use these calm areas to store weapons in them, so they can use them at a later time.
Finding explosive devices that were made recently is a dangerous indication that military support continues to be provided to armed groups who oppose the political process in Iraq. This puts the Iraqi forces into a difficult situation and makes it difficult for them to maintain their current security achievements.
شهدت مدينة دبي الإماراتية إقامة البطولة.
The annual international competition of Arabian horses was held in Dubai. More than 390 horses participated in the three-day competition.
جوهدا إلى التفاصيل.
شهدت مدينة دبي الإماراتية إقامة.
Dubai hosted the international competition of Arabian horses, which is considered to be one of the most important competitions in the world. The total sum of awards presented at this competition reached $4 million. The objective of this competition is to commemorate the Arabian horse, which is a symbol of beauty, strength, and tolerance in the Arab world.
In the Arab world, the Arabian horse is a symbol of beauty and pride. Arabian horses were used in wars. If you go to any Arab country, you will find Arabian horses. I have a special love for Arabian horses.
وتنافس على جوائز هذا العام أكثر من 300.
More than 390 Arabian horses competed at this event. Some believed that the competition was affected by the international financial crisis.
تشير إلى أن عدد الخيول التي شاركت في بطولة العام الحالي بلغ.
This year, 392 horses participated in this competition. Last year, only 295 horses competed.
طبعا في هذا شيء اساسي اللي هم تكلموا عنه بخصوص الازمه.
There is talk about the effects of the international financial crisis. This year, however, we had more guests than in previous years. God willing, it will get better and better every year.
نتوقع ان يكون احسن واحسن.
والحصان العربي من اقدم سلالات الخيول الركوب في العالم.
The Arabian horse is one of the oldest horses in the world and has unique qualities such as strength and intelligence. It has been able to achieve a prominent place in international competitions. The Arabian horse competition is very popular in the United Arab Emirates. It is worth mentioning that the International Horse Racing Competition, which is also known as the Dubai World Cup, will take place on March 28th at the Nahd al Sheba Racecourse in the city of Dubai. Some of the most famous horses in the world will participate.
Get more news about the Middle East online at linktv.org/mosaic. The Mosaic webpage offers a complete archive of Mosaic programs, program transcripts, the Mosaic Video Podcast, and the Mosaic Intelligence Report, a weekly analysis of the hottest stories from the Middle East. The views expressed on Mosaic are those of the participating broadcasters, not Link TV or its sponsors. The production of Mosaic is made possible with the support of viewers like you. Thank you.
This program is brought to you by Link TV for educational and non-commercial use only. Link TV is the only U.S. network dedicated to global and national news, uncompromising documentaries, and diverse cultural programs, programs which connect you to the world.